Chronicle Books presents Touch Matters, written and read by Professor Michael Banissy. Introduction. What does touch mean to you? On the face of it, this is a relatively simple question. Yet, with a sense so intimately linked to our daily lives, the answer is far from straightforward. Under the term falls the most intimate and the most formal of behaviours. A caress, a hug, a handshake. Touch can bring pleasure, touch can bring pain. Touch can trigger a complexity of emotions and memories. Many might be able to recall a time when the experience of touch brought them closer to other people. What made that experience special? What was it about the quality of tactile communication that helped you connect with someone else? Caring physical contact like hugging or hand-holding is vital to convey reassurance, empathy, and affection. These touches act as a social glue, helping to form and reinforce bonds between us. The relationships that touch facilitates are essential because social connections are vital for our health and well-being. The proven benefits of strong social connections include increased longevity, a strengthened immune system, and positive mental health. One landmark study found that people with stronger social relationships have a 50% increased likelihood of survival compared to those with weaker social connections. Touch is a core ingredient in social contact, helping to generate a positive loop for social, emotional, and physical well-being to thrive. The benefits of touch on physical and mental health extend further. For instance, as we will learn later in this book, even a short and gentle touch has been found to lower anxiety, reduce stress, and decrease symptoms of depression in the person who is touched. Many of us might be able to recall a time when a simple comforting touch made a difference. Can you think of a time when you consoled someone? Or perhaps a time when touch helped calm you before a stressful event like having an operation? In some cases, the support provided by touch can be more of an aid to help people overcome adverse events than words alone. As a social neuroscientist, someone who studies the brain basis of social interaction, I've been fascinated by touch for many years. In my work, I've sought to understand why we touch others and what happens when we do. What drives differences between us in how we think and feel about touch? What is it about the quality of tactile communication that so positively impacts our relationships, happiness, and health? From working in a laboratory to observing people in the real world, I've tried to get a handle on the meaning of touch from the earliest stages of life to our final moments. I've tried to understand what makes touch so fundamental to human connection and existence. Through this work, I've been lucky to investigate touch with people from various backgrounds and in different settings. Some examples include the role of touch in the workplace, in theatre and dance, in healthcare, and across our daily relationships. I've worked closely with organisations to try to find ways to balance the positives that come from appropriate and supportive touch with the importance of keeping consent at the heart of our interactions. And with those seeking to develop new approaches to ensure that even if we lack touch in our lives, we can still have access to opportunities to experience the positive outcomes that supportive touch can bring. Away from my work as a scientist, touch is an integral part of my life, as it is for many of us. It's a sense that has often brought me comfort, a sense that has helped me to share a connection with others, a sense that has helped me explore and understand the world around me. While touch can be positive, there's no doubt that it can also be challenging. The words I've written above will not resonate with everyone. I fully acknowledge that I am privileged to have had a positive relationship with touch throughout my life. Many have not. Sadly, touch is a sense that has often been misused. Nowadays, you do not have to search far to find examples of exploitation or abuse through touch. Egregious examples of inappropriate touch and sexual harassment are distressingly common. The volume of reports from across the world of people abusing their license to touch others has been a troubling feature of recent times. Considering this, I can understand why some people have argued that we should place greater scrutiny on the impact of touch and consent. We know that touch affects us all, but its meaning is often complicated and nuanced. What might be a meaningless touch to some may be significant to others. Our thoughts about touch are often subconscious and connected to our personal history of tactile experiences. This is true from person to person, but can even be the case with the same person from situation to situation. Can you imagine an example where you might feel comfortable with touch in one setting but not another? If your hairdresser touched your arm or shoulder while in the salon, it might be okay. But what if they stroked your arm to greet you in the coffee shop? Context matters, and we'll explore this more in detail later. We rely on touch every day of our lives. It makes us who we are. It helps us connect. Despite this, many feel out of touch with the world. Studies suggest that over half of us long for more touch in our lives, but people increasingly report a reluctance to touch. When we touch, we must navigate a delicate landscape of past, present, and future encounters. How do we balance these competing factors? How can we ensure that our tactile behaviors are most appropriate for the individual needs of each person we interact with? Maybe you've thought about these questions yourself. Perhaps you have not. The reality is that touch is a sense that impacts many parts of our lives in unexpected ways. Yet, we seldom stop to consider our everyday tactile interactions. Until recently, that is. On 21st of January 2020, I woke up in a hotel room in the heart of Media City, a 200-acre development besides the Manchester Ship Canal in Salford. Historically known as one of the world's most extensive river navigation canals, the Manchester Ship Canal is heralded as a feat of Victorian engineering that connected the city to global trade routes. Today, its banks are somewhat different. They are home to some of the UK's world-leading media organisations, including the British Broadcasting Corporation, or the BBC, as it's more commonly referred to. I had a big day ahead of me, a string of radio and television interviews throughout the day until a final appearance on the BBC Evening News. Why? Touch. We were launching what would become one of the world's largest contemporary studies on people's attitudes to and experience of touch around the globe, a study called the Touch Test. That morning, in January 2020, we had no idea what was coming our way. On the very same day as our launch, the first confirmed case of coronavirus was identified in Washington State, USA. The previous day, epidemiologists from the Chinese Center for Disease Control and Prevention published an article indicating that the first cluster of patients with pneumonia of an unknown cause had been identified on 21st of December 2019. At the end of January 2020, the Director General of the World Health Organization declared a public health emergency. In the following weeks, the stark reality of the scale of this emergency became clearer. The number of world cases surpassed 100,000 in March 2020, then 1 million in April. At the time of writing, the current global number of cases stands at 691 million, with 6.71 million deaths. COVID-19 changed the world. COVID-19 was also a game changer for how we touched. As societies understood that the virus could spread through close contact, various restrictions and new social norms developed. National lockdowns were introduced, with strict rules limiting interactions with others outside our households and ordering people to stay home. Public health messages advised regularly sanitizing hands and urged people not to touch their faces. We were warned to keep our distance from each other and to be cautious of touch. As a touch researcher, I always thought I understood the importance of touch in our lives. Yet, like many people, it was not until touch was taken away that I realised just how important it was to me. For many, the past few years have put touch into focus. This forgotten sense has returned to the public eye. When we launched our global touch test study, we did not know how many people would complete it. But even though COVID-19 took hold during our testing period, close to 40,000 people living in 112 different countries took part. The timing could not be controlled. The test was even referred to as one of the most ill-timed scientific surveys carried out. Yet, it turned out to be a fascinating window into what touch meant to different people across the globe at a time when they were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.